Okay, good morning, everybody, and welcome to this week's virtual plant clinic. My name is Bill Lester. I'm with University of Florida Extension Service here in Hernando County. And joining me today is Lily Browning, who is our Hernando County Florida Friendly Landscape Coordinator, who is technically employed by Hernando County Utilities Department. I think I got all that correct, didn't I?
Pretty good.
Okay, yeah, that's pretty impressive.
Close enough for government work.
Exactly.
Exactly what I do is government work. So. Yes, that was good. And I more than technically, I mean, I literally work for Hernando County Utilities in water conservation.
And that's where you are today. You're in the utilities water building.
I am.
And I am. In my lovely office here today.
I'm in my little studio.
I'm in my little cave.
Which is a corner of a bigger room.
So. I'm in my messy office with poor lighting. Good thing that I have at least one spotlight so that people can see me.
Mm-hmm. I've told you. Just one of these. These are great.
I need to get one of those. I think I ordered one a while back and it never got ordered or shipped because Mary has to handle the Amazon ordering things now. It's very, very complicated.
This is, you know, it's cheap enough. This is just Lily's personal ring. But see what happens when I face it at me.
I see a ring.
Yes. See, that's the downside of having glasses. So I have to turn it away from me, but it still, you know, brings some nice light in. Aside from, oh yeah, above me, that light is off. Oh no. you know, the fluorescent harsh lights. And it gives you three different shades that I can be. See? See my skin tone changing?
Yes. Well, okay. I'm going to have to do this on the iPad and just drag it outside one day and we'll broadcast live from the front yard.
Okay.
Hey, I should do it live for my vegetable garden one day.
That would be great. Yeah.
Yeah, that's a thought.
Winter vegetable garden. Yes. Sounds like a great idea.
Mm-hmm.
Yesterday, I'll turn
the camera to show the birds and the squirrels. And we had vultures flying around the backyard apparently yesterday. And every winter we have owls that live in our neighborhood. So when I get up and it's still dark and I go to put the dog out, he encounters owls in the backyard.
Be careful putting the little tiny dog out or the owl might encounter him.
We have vultures flying around the neighborhood.
Well, that means you've got something dead out there somewhere.
And they saw the little tiny one and Nora had to pick her up.
Well, the vultures aren't going to bother with her while she's living.
They might. It's only 5 pounds.
Yeah, but they will eat carrion. You know that.
Well, they can take care of that. I would think it's possible. We need to have somebody who knows more about animals.
I have never heard of vultures actually being predators. They are garbage disposals.
They can be because other ones can be both bald eagles. Are predators, but they'll eat garbage alongside the road.
Yes. My husband used to work at the landfill, so he has seen, you know, all this wildlife in action and eagles in action, and mm-hmm. David Attenborough standing out there at the landfill narrating. No, not really, but he says eagles are bullies. And they will wait for the seagulls to get something good and try and fly away with it, and they'll take it from them.
Oh, that's terrible.
They would rather do that than do the work themselves. And they would have a tendency to want to challenge the heavy equipment out there. Oh. If it was like when they were eating something, if it was coming towards them, they would buck up and challenge the heavy equipment, and my husband would be like, you know, I don't think that's a good idea for you to do that. But once a human walked out of it, they'd fly away. So
Yeah, I know. If you're into bird watching, arrange to go and tour the landfill. That's where they all hang out during the winter.
Absolutely. There's a lot of eagles. So yeah, he had to learn to work around them certain times of year. And hawks, and, you know, that's a wonderful buffet out there. So
yeah,
that's why the seagulls are there that far from the Gulf, because, heck, a lot more opportunity. I mean, they're very conscientious, and they have to follow a lot of EPA rules about keeping everything covered. By the end of the day, everything has to be covered, but there's still some, you know, good eatings to get for the birds while the guys are doing their work. So
birds got to eat too, I guess.
Yeah,
so.
Yeah.
So good morning, everybody. I see we have a number of regular participants on here already today. If you guys have any lawn and garden questions, any comments, anything you'd like to share, just go ahead and feel free to put them in the comments.
I was going to say, you and I presented a compost bin and rain barrel workshop yesterday at the Hernando County Master Gardener Nursery. And I think that went really well. It's a bit too warm for December, I thought. I mean, it was kind of nice out there, but I still got sweaty. And I don't appreciate that in December.
Well, I remember last year, it was really nice weather all the way through Christmas, because Christmas was just absolutely beautiful, sunny and warm during the day, cool at night. We didn't get any really bad freezes or really bad cold fronts until after Christmas.
Yeah.
And I haven't gotten it.
Because we had another workshop in January last year. We're doing around the same time at the same place in January this year on a Saturday at one of our environmentally sensitive land areas. Carmen and I are doing that. And it was cold when we started out. I mean, people were in big jackets and stuff. I would say it was in the low 40s when we started it. But then we also took a walk around the woods. So, you know, by noon, everyone was shedding their jackets and stuff. I prefer that than standing out there and getting sweaty. But where we had your class, it's in the shade. So
yep.
Outdoor classroom. I really appreciate the Master Gardeners, you know, allowing us to hold classes there, hold events there.
Get in their way.
It get in their way. It usually ends up having some financial benefit for them. So, you know, it kind of works out. Yes, little did we know, you know, just through a series of events, Carmen, who provides our compost bins from the solid waste division, was not able to personally be there. And that's fine, because you teach the class wonderfully, but we needed the actual bins. They come from him. So he sent his worker, who got there in plenty of time before the class started. But he's coming in this big box truck. And what happened the exact same time on that exact moment in time?
They were there trimming the trees.
So three or four very large tree trimming trucks. And they were all gathered at the gate when I was trying to get in a small car. But luckily, they were a little more dispersed when Greeny came with the big box truck. And they also magically went further away from us when we went to teach the class. So
yeah, that was nice. I didn't have to scream to be heard.
Yep. Carol has a question, and we discussed that yesterday in the class.
Yes, Carol has a composter, or she had a composter several years ago, but stopped using it because she started having a roach problem. Any suggestions?
First of all, describe what a roach problem is to you, because that can be different things to different people. One or two roaches in your compost bin, even five or six, is not necessarily a roach problem. If it's loaded with roaches, then there might be, you know, different techniques you need to take in the composting process. Right, Bill?
Exactly. And I mean, for me personally, roaches in the house or in the garage are a problem.
Absolutely.
A couple of roaches in my compost bin, which I set at the other end of the backyard from the house, is not a problem, because roaches outdoors are a natural part of the natural environment, and you can't sanitize the great outdoors. So you're going to have some roaches out there.
She said it was loaded with roaches. I would say that's the material then, possibly, that went in. Too many greens, not enough browns.
Exactly. Probably a little too heavy on kitchen scraps and things like that. If you had worked in maybe some shredded paper, ground leaves, ground pine needles, some high carbon materials to balance out the high nitrogen wet materials, it would have been less attractive to the roaches.
There's going to be some. I hate roaches. There's nothing, you know, no other critters that really just, you know, do that to me. Roaches do. I do not like them, but they are part of the composting, you know, decompose. They're decomposers. They're part of that cycle in the natural world. So if you see a few in your compost bin, that's going to happen. But having it loaded, I would have problems with that too. And yeah, maybe that the only suggestion I would have is get it a little drier, add more of the leaves and grass and yard clippings, like you said, shredded paper, something to be a little less slimy, you know, in there.
Because what you're doing is you're just trying to make it less attractive for them, and then realize that you're always going to have some. You just don't want, you want to minimize it. There's no way to eliminate them, because almost all the different species of roaches that live in Florida prefer to live outside. They want to live in your compost bin, in your mulch, in the flat, in the, you know, mulch, whether it's leaf mulch or pine bark around your flower beds, and that's where they want to live. That's where they want to, they're feeding on the organic matter out there.
Mm-hmm.
There aren't many species that really prefer living inside of your house. The problem is if you have
those little ones, the German roaches.
Yeah, yeah, German / Asian cockroaches are the exception, and if you ever get them in your house, those you probably need to call a professional. But most others are roaches that want to live outside that accidentally wander into your house. Or maybe you'll get a few in the garage and they'll start to mate, and now you start to have some in your garage. That happens to me every summer, but I know it's going to happen. And I have a wonderful roach bait that comes in this big fat syringe, basically. So I pull it out of the package, crawl around back in the corners in the garage, and just a little squirt, squirt, squirt.
You,
oh my gosh, in 2 or 3 days, they're all gone.
Right, or put that behind some receptacles, take the switch plates off, put those there too.
Yeah, that's what you can do, or a professional is going to do, probably more in your kitchen, your bathroom, or inside. You could do that in the walls and receptacles out in your garage, but mine tend to just kind of gravitate towards the cardboard that we do have out there. I haven't been able to get rid of all the cardboard, but I minimize it. And I get a few of the Australian roaches, the really big ones, but I put down the bait, and within a few days, they're gone. Problem solved.
Yep. And also then don't have your compost bin, you know, right up against the house. Kind of put it at the back of the yard, but at a place where it is also still convenient that you will use it. So.
Exactly. You don't want to put compost piles or a compost bin up against your house. You really want to be careful with any kind of wood chip mulch that you're using in the beds. You don't want to pile it up against the wall of your house. It gives pests a way to kind of quietly get to the wall of your house and enter without you even noticing. So they recommend that you pull it back at least a few inches from the wall of your house. All around my house, and this is something I didn't do, it came with the house. I have about 3 or 4 foot bed of landscape rocks all the way around the house.
But the University of Florida, what they say, if you are concerned with your mulch and termites, they say that the rock barrier still provides moisture there, which still gives them a conduit to your home. So they suggest kind of just bare soil. The problem with that is, as you know, bare soil is going to grow something.
Yeah.
At some point. So I guess you just have to keep that area weed-eated or so. So there's different schools of thought.
Yeah, I think the important point is going out there and actually checking or having a professional check around your house once or twice a year, whatever you choose, because none of those ways are perfect. So obviously, if you have lots of bushes up against your house and you have wood chip mulch, things could be going on. You could be having a termite problem and you're not going to notice it because you're not crawling around normally underneath the bushes. I have hollies out in front of my house and I do not like crawling around them too much because I get really scratched up.
Yeah.
Bare rocks aren't perfect because things could go underneath the rocks and still get in. So unless you walk the house and check and, kind of look around through the rocks, sure, you're not going to know for sure what's happening.
But you really, as you said, don't want to take all your mulch and have it touching the house.
Yeah. And then bare dirt, you will grow a beautiful crop of weeds and nobody mm-hmm. likes weeds. And now you're having to pull them or spray them or deal
with them. You're still going to get weeds up through the rocks too. And rocks in Florida, they're not going to be there long. Within a year, they will be gone. So they do tend to migrate down into our sand.
Yeah, I do get some sand that kind of gravitates up. I spray mine with herbicide on a regular basis. Keeps it pretty clear.
Cindy has a rubber tree question.
Yes. Cindy has a rubber tree that she took from a cutting. She knows very little about them. Back then, up north, they would stay in a pot forever. That's true. It's a very common house plant mm-hmm. up north. So my two little cuttings now about 8 to 10 feet tall, that's pretty big, and close to the house. I wanted to keep it trimmed, but now I just read the roots can cause damage. Should I remove it or can I keep it contained somehow? I really love watching the new leaf growth.
This is definitely a South Florida question.
Do you think rubber trees, they're roots are going to be enough to damage a house, a patio, concrete?
I do not know.
I wouldn't think so.
We can't grow them up here out in the landscape, so I don't know.
Well, you can, but they're going to get freeze damage up here pretty much every winter.
Right.
And if they're in a protected spot, they're just going to get damaged. They're not going to die. They come back, but it takes all summer long for them to grow back, just in time to get frozen again, so they never get huge.
Right, but I don't think you can, if the roots are a problem, I don't think you can control the roots, somehow without, removing the tree. We would have to look that up and maybe get back to you to see if rubber tree, I don't know even how strong the roots are or if they cause any issues. Any kind of tree real close to the house could cause issues. You need to ask yourself how far your drain field is. That might be another, issue to consider.
Yeah, and I would think that if this is a rubber tree like the traditional one that's used as a house plant up north, I wouldn't think that the roots from it are going to be your biggest concern. Having a plant that is that large right up against the house, if it leans up against the house, if it's touching the eaves, if it's touching the roof, now it provides a perfect little highway for insects and ants and potentially mice and rats and all kinds of other things out there to get access to your roof, to get up into your house. So having a lot of plants, it may look good sometimes to have a very tropical looking yard with lots of plant material all around your house. It's kind of like you live in the middle of the jungle in Costa Rica. Very, very bad from a pest control standpoint.
And it says that they are weak. I'm looking at a University of Florida publication mm-hmm. on the Ficus elastica. I love that. Use as a street tree is limited by the tree's tendency to break apart in strong winds. So could be made stronger by removing some of the branches in with weak tight angle, you know, those. And spacing major lateral branches along one central trunk. Now, yeah, if you're going that from a cutting and now it's getting, you know, as big as it is, you know, is it too late to start training it to have one central trunk, or do you think she should work on that?
It depends on what shape the plant has at this point. Something, since, you know, Cindy, you live down in Pinellas County, and obviously they grow really, really well down there, fairly problem-free. If these look like they're too close to the house, try taking cuttings from them, and then eventually plan on removing these.
Mm-hmm.
And
that's always an idea.
Always have rubber tree plant, but always have it small. So keep replacing it, basically.
It does say here can form large surface roots.
Yeah, they'll get the roots to stay like on the surface or above the surface. It can be a trip hazard. I don't know if it's in a spot that you try to walk through. You have to be careful not to trip on
but
it.
But also, you're not going to be able to grow anything else under
yeah.
it either.
And they do get brittle. And if they get basically too large and too old, they're going to break up in a storm anyway.
To find this, Cindy, you can just do what I did, which I just Googled rubber tree UF, and I found this information. So, and I'm going to have high hopes in my head the rest of the day, just so you know that. Was that about the ant moving the rubber tree? And he's got high hopes.
I knew you were going to start singing it.
Yep.
And here I have a link for it, and I'll go ahead and put that in the comments.
Okay, you good. You found the link.
Yep. See, this is why we've been so terribly lost without Teresa here, because Teresa would have had that link up 5 minutes ago.
Yeah, she would have been sitting in the background having all that info instead of just reading it to you off of her phone like I'm doing. Oh, she says it's about 4 feet away. And all those things has convinced her to remove it and take new cuttings. That was a very good idea, Bill, too. You know, she doesn't have to lose them because she's already knows how to do the cuttings. And maybe put them a little further in the yard where you don't mind those surface roots going to be spreading and maybe causing things that aren't going to grow, you know, under it.
And you'll always have them. But over time, you cannot, especially outdoors, do anything to a plant to kind of, other than turning it into a bonsai somehow, I guess. And I don't think rubber trees really lend themselves to bonsai.
No, it does. It talks about how to keep them smaller, but no, not bonsaiing them, but having, so when you start the new cuttings, start training early to have that one central leader. And so it's going to make it smaller and also stronger.
Mm-hmm. Good question.
Do you have any other questions? That was a good one. That one challenged us. We're going to know some
challenging one.
We're going to know more about South Florida plants, but you know, in the next few years.
Well, you shared that they kind of adjusted the growing zones, and now technically here we're warmer than we were. And we're here in Hernando County, you can legitimately try, and I'm not going to guarantee you that it's not going to freeze and die, but you can definitely give a shot to growing a lot of tropical fruit trees, things like mangoes. I need to get a lychee tree.
I wouldn't put a lot of money into it because you're still taking a risk.
Yeah.
But just so you know that you're experimenting. I had my photographer in here. Right?
Okay.
No, you asked for it. You wanted pictures taken. Mm-hmm. my paparazzi was in here. Yes, I have just saw that the USDA's horticultural zone map, where we always, Hernando County was squarely all of it in 9A. Now they have adjusted some things to where the southeastern corner, like Masaryk Town, Avalon, and then further up.
Four Corners?
No, I don't think so, not quite yet.
Hey, it looked like I was at the very edge of that map now.
It looked, yeah, kind of like I would say Anderson Snow East. And then Spring Lake and all of Ridge Manor, all that eastern area, they have decided is 9B. And one little tiny spot up in the northwestern, way northwestern, I think even more north than me, like on the Citrus County line on 19. Small part of that on the Chaz, I think is what it is, the, you know, on the Chazawitzka River, they're giving that a 9B. Not a huge difference between 9A and 9B, but sometimes it is when it comes to frost, you know, protection of plants and things like that. What it is telling me is, of course, you know, for whatever reason, which we are not going to argue today, you know, whether it's secular, whether it's brought on by man-made activity or a combination of both, you know, climate change is a thing. So what we can do is experiment with some of those trees and plants that they can grow in South Florida. Just know, I'm not talking 10A plant. I'm not talking plants that will only grow in the Keys or Miami, because you are going to have
to grow those. Like jackfruit, and there are some very, very tropical plants that they grow down just in South Florida. And they're probably not going to do well here, but there's quite a few that may do that you can legitimately try growing here.
On the other hand, you might want, I've seen it happen, trees that were on their southern limits, and we were really, really pushing for many years, like dogwoods, you know, in Hernando, it was in And, you know, years ago, before you were here, dogwoods were very common to see, especially more in the Brooksville area, with that clay soil and stuff. Mm-hmm. It's becoming less common. If you think you're seeing them in the woods in the spring when you're driving by, know you're seeing the Chickasaw plums or the Flatwoods plum trees. Dogwoods have a couple of things going on. Across the country, they have experienced a anthracnose disease, which is affecting all the dogwoods, but the Florida dogwoods, I think our issue with growing them here is we were always on the southernmost border, and now it's kind of moving. So Buddy should still be okay, you know, trying to grow them, but they're not doing that great here anymore. It's getting just a little too warm, even by those few degrees. So that is sad. But like you said, then that kind of opens up more opportunity, I guess, to experiment with the more tropical type plants, maybe even rubber tree.
So you can do it. You just need to put some planning behind it. Mm-hmm. So if I was to go out and buy a mango tree this weekend and just stick it in the middle of my front yard, it would get plenty of sun. That's a very good thing.
At some point, yeah.
Yeah, the problem is on a really cold night, I'm going to have to go out there with blankets and really, really serious cold protection, because it's not protected at all out in the middle of my front yard. Now, I have other spots in my yard that are a little bit more protected, going to stay a few degrees warmer, hopefully, and this varies year by year, but hopefully there's not a lot of really cold nights where you're going to have to worry about your plant getting damaged. We already mentioned that so far, I mean, heck, this is December 8th, and it's beautiful out there. It's supposed to be 80-ish today, so.
Yeah, that's too warm for December. After our workshop, and, you know, if it was June, I couldn't have even been out there. I don't even do well with the heat. But after our workshop, I took my lunch and ran home and showered and changed.
See, it wasn't that hot. Come on.
Not for me. I don't like sitting around in perspiration the rest of the afternoon.
Yeah, no, it was warm, but depending on what you're trying to grow, that can be a good thing. So if you're trying to grow tropical fruit, warm is a very, very good thing. If you're trying to grow temperate fruit, warm, too much warm and no cold can be a big problem. So if you're trying to grow blackberries, blueberries, peaches, plums, and nectarines.
You gotta get the Florida varieties, low chill.
Apples, they're all low chill, but they still need chill. So if we have a no chill kind of winter, they're probably not gonna flower and set fruit very well.
Mm-hmm. And then, you know, sometimes we do. Oh, we've never had a winter where it hasn't had one or two days of below 32 nights, I should say.
Yeah.
But it's not as cold as it was 20, 30 years ago.
And I'm sure it's coming up because we got January and February to get through and we will get some cold. But then it comes down to exactly how many hours of cold. Was it enough? Was it so much that it froze everybody's Thai plants or tea plants or mangoes?
Yeah, usually that's all that's going to happen is we'll get cold enough to freeze our fire bush and our hibiscus.
Yeah.
but not their roots. I mean, they'll come back. So it gets cold enough to make your yard ugly, but not to do any major, major damage. We used to, when I started out working for Extension, we're almost in 2023, so almost 24 years ago. It was not unusual for a St. Augustine floritam lawn to die by being frozen. You don't hear of that anymore at all.
Never see that anymore.
No. Maybe Buddy might have, you know, run into some of those issues, but it does not happen in Hernando County anymore. I mean, yeah, they'll turn brown. That's okay. That's just your lawn going into a winter dormancy. I continue to try and change attitudes for people who come down and think they must have green all year long. A golden lawn is part of our winter scene here. I just did a class last week on Florida friendly landscaping for the part-time resident and was talking about, you know, these golden lawns and that's okay. And I tell them, there are very legitimate reasons that you choose to spend winters down here. If you want to see everything green, then come in the summer and suffer through the heat. It is winter and it'll look like winter and that's okay.
And your lawns should be going dormant definitely at this point and turning tan, not growing very fast.
Golden, Bill. They're golden lawns.
And I know that I appreciate not having to cut it as much.
Yes.
Gives me a nice little break. That's all totally normal. And there's nothing we can do to change that. You're not going to have a perfect whatever you're shooting for, golf course looking type lawn year round, it's just not going to happen. We're back on the rubber tree.
She wants you to experiment.
Cindy wants me to try growing a rubber tree as an experiment. And yeah, south of here, it is very hardy. Anywhere in South Florida, a rubber tree plant and some of those different things that maybe most people think of as a house plant in a pot up north, you can plant them in the ground outside and they're going to grow like weeds. They're going to take off.
But just remember, fast growing usually means weak,
brittle, potentially invasive.
The UF publication said it's not showing any invasive tendencies at this time.
Yeah, I know the houseplant philodendrons.
Mm-hmm.
People will plant them outside and have them grow up into trees, and they do that very well south of here. that could be a problem. That could become invasive if they end up in a wild area, a park area. They can become an invasive weed in that situation.
Mm-hmm. Here, Chef Lara, I think, can do the same thing.
Yeah. Here, if you do that, chances are really, really good that we're going to have a cold night and it's going to kill it. It mm-hmm. knocks it way back. The next spring, it has to start from the beginning and go back. So it never gets terribly out of control. And Lee down in Broward County says, don't plant it in the ground. I had to get rid of my rubber plant because it got too big. Okay. So it could happen.
Let's talk about, since it's that time of year, and the snake plants.
Yeah. Snake plants. That's one of my
Sansevieria, mother-in-law tongues. Those are
we allowed to say mother-in-law's tongues? Is that politically incorrect now?
I don't know. Go home and ask your mother-in-law. Chef Lara, like I said, is also mm-hmm. found its way on the invasive list if you try and plant it in the yard. I'm not getting a signal. I'm trying to find. I have Frank Sinatra, but I can't bring him up singing that song. I was going to mention holiday plants. Let's talk about some of those. Specifically, what I'm thinking about is right now, in every single year, I walk by one and I think, you are so cute. I want you so much. One of those little.
The Norfolk Island pine.
Thank you. Yep. The Norfolk. See, we work together a lot. Norfolk Island pines. You'll find them in every big box store. And they have them so cute. They make them like little Christmas trees in a pot. And they're kind of weepy. And they're so cute. Well, a couple of things will happen around here. Those things grow fast. And they grow outrageously tall. I mean, it'll stand out above the oak tree line like twice as tall.
Like a massive green pencil, and they'll get twice as tall as your house.
Right. More than that. More than twice as tall as your house. And they grow fast. And here they could freeze, so that may not happen. Despite its name, Norfolk, it's a tropical tree, Norfolk Island pine. And it's none of those. So if you get it and you plant it, if you're one of our South Florida people, it's going to grow to be a million feet tall. And it can start looking funky after a bit. Some of them here, they will grow and get frost damaged, but keep growing. So they look odd. They look odd anyway, even if it was perfect. The bigger it gets, it's not that weeping cute thing anymore. It's like, looks like a tree Dr. Seuss would draw. And it's not a great landscape plant. And again, you know, grows quickly, so it's going to be weak in a storm. They are so cute. The only thing I could say to do about them is if you want to keep them and put them in a pot and then keep putting them in a bigger pot and leave them on your porch till it outgrows your porch and then decide what do you do with it then. You might have to just end up composting it then, because it's not a great landscape plant.
No, at some point it will eventually become a big problem that you're going to have to deal with. So know that up front.
Yeah. If you can't stand the not getting them because they're so cute, then I would suggest then just keeping them until they're too tall for your porch to handle. I would say give them to a South Florida friend, but then they're going to have the problem of this outrageously tall and weak tree. If you want to get something like that, you know, in that pot that's a living type thing, I would get one of those rosemary that they've shaped to look like, you know, a little pine tree. It's not going to retain that shape, obviously, but then you can plant that in your landscape and really enjoy it. So that's what I would do. If you are in a tiny house or, you know, or full-time RVer or something, looking for something to, you know, bring in the holidays, I would get one of those little rosemary pot things and then either give it to a friend or just keep it until it's too big and then get, but you can give that to a friend without feeling guilty about it.
Yeah, and I just looked it up, and people, when they hear Norfolk Island pine, they might think that it comes from like Norfolk, Virginia.
Yeah.
Nope. It actually comes from Norfolk Island. And
which is
because
where
we want to be educational here, it is a very small island in the South Pacific area.
I'm sorry, where was it?
Way out in the middle of nothing between Australia and New Zealand.
And I wonder if they're funky looking. That is, that explains everything, why they look like Dr. Seuss drawn trees, because they're from that area of the world where everything looks different.
And that would be a real cool experience to go there for a visit. I need to think about that.
Okay.
I'll go and see if I can find Norfolk Island pines growing in their native range.
There you go.
How's that?
So you can
I'll see if work will pay for it.
So you can be out in the jungle like Dr. Livingston.
There you go.
So and look for rubber trees while you're out there.
Geography lesson for today. So if anybody has any other questions, please feel free to go ahead and put them in the comments.
Oh, wait. There you go. Oh, okay.
Next on your phone with your chin on the ground, there's a lot to be learned. So look around.
Just what makes that little old lamp think he'll move that rubber tree plant? Anyone knows an ant can't move a rubber tree plant.
But he's not.
I wonder if Facebook is going to catch this and kick this episode off.
Well, I got it from YouTube.
Yeah, they
might. Just in certain countries.
Yeah, now we'll be banned off Norfolk Island.
I happen to inadvertently use a phrase that's from a song. It tells me, it gives me a little note that says, in these 17 countries, we have muted that area, but it's not in the United States. It's so weird because, you know me, I inadvertently use song phrases all the time, but and apparently that gets me in trouble in 17 countries, so they mute out that particular phrase. Like for one, I used it was about the monarchs, and on one slide I had the particular monarch population that stays in California, and I named that slide California Dreaming. That got muted out. And there's a couple of phrases I have used. I can't even remember now, but I know they were Beatles songs. I think it's Let It Be, you know, B-E-E, something like that. And I got put on notice about that. And I thought, well, I can understand that because I don't want Yoko coming after me and suing me. So.
Yeah. Hitting you up for some money or something.
So Frank Sinatra's probably going to be okay with us, though. So.
Probably. And, you know, there is a ton of free music out there. There are a lot of different services have it. As a matter of fact, here on StreamYard, we have some.
Mm-hmm.
Most of the music isn't very good, really. That's very relaxing. If anybody thinks that we need to do clinics in the future, some nice mood music in the background, we all stay calm about our lawns, our landscape, our turf grass. Don't want to get your blood pressure up because you have a problem with your lawn. Just
you've got
deep breath and we'll all figure out what the problem is and we'll come up with a solution.
You have a fantastic voice for that.
Yeah, we may do that again in the future. You know, that's a thought.
Yeah. Calm Gardening Thoughts with Dr. Bill Lester. My plants will grow.
Should we try to do an episode on garden meditation?
No, that might actually be pretty good. You're gardening for your health, and for the health of it. Gardening for the health of it.
Write that one down.
Okay. Some other holiday plants, while we were discussing holiday plants. My pastor is from Alabama, and he has started saying over a month ago, you know, telling people that it's time to sign up for red Christmas plants. Because he says he won't say it because he doesn't know how, and he's only going to say poinsettia, and he doesn't want it to, you know, to be teased about. I've never heard it called that. I call their poinsettias. And you can grow poinsettias in Florida yards, right, Dr. Lester?
Yes, you can. And if you put them in the right spot and they're happy, they can do really, really well. I've seen people with either an individual plant or a clump or even a hedge, and you can grow them 6 feet tall if you want and manage them.
Well, I've seen the older ones, some of the older houses seem to be more likely to have poinsettias in their yard, and I've seen them as tall as the roof of the house. I think, you know, if they bought those poinsettias in 1970, you know, and planted them, the poinsettias, there weren't as many varieties, and they weren't as forced grown in greenhouses as they are now. So I think they had better luck with less input, you know, growing in the landscape. The ones you just grab from the grocery store or something may or may not make it, but, you know, you already had it, so you can try it. What we basically say to do, you do things with poinsettias in the A months, correct? So if you have it in your pot, you want to wait till April to plant it and then prune it in August, no later, or you won't get your bracts. And how the bracts turn red is by having zero light at night. So, you know, if you try and put it by your porch and your porch light's on, that may interfere. Street lights, things like that. I say that, but I've told you this story before. I knew a gentleman who worked at a funeral home next door to a church, and he would take, you know, second week in January or so, all the dead poinsettias that no one picked up from the church and plant them by the funeral home. There's a street light there, porch mm-hmm. light there. Those poinsettias had not read the books or the publications, and they grew just fine. So, you know, sometimes it just depends. I told him I did not want to know what he put in that soil to make the poinsettias grow. And then he mumbled something about bone meal. But anyway, so, you know, again, that's an experiment worth trying. And yeah. I'm going to segue. Wednesday, this coming Wednesday, I will be in person at the Spring Hill Branch Library, 9220 Spring Hill Drive, at 2:30 in the afternoon, talking about the care of holiday plants. And then on Wednesday, the 21st, I will have a Zoom class, you know, a few days before Christmas. It was a rescheduled class about container gardening. So when I rescheduled it to that date, I'm like, I'll just throw some of that holiday landscape or holiday plant care in that same program. So those are two opportunities to learn more about the holiday plants. Like how I segued right into that?
Very good. Let me segue right into scrolling some things on the screen here. If you ever want to find out what kind of classes we have going on and exactly where we're doing them and when we're doing them and what the link is, and are you on Facebook Live or YouTube or in person, Don't ask me, because I get confused about exactly what we're doing any given day. So I'm going to have to look it up and double check to find out exactly what we're doing. But the easiest way to do it is don't call and ask me. Go to www.hernandoextension.com, scrolling right down there. And that has a full listing. It's fed right after we put it up on Facebook. It ends up on there. And that's a really good way to follow along with everything that we have going on. Of course, following both of us on Facebook is a really great thing to do also. Just emailing Lily directly a lot.
I have a forward button. That's fine.
We'll keep her busy and keep her from getting bored. And she can answer all your questions and tell you exactly what's going on and what we're doing.
Because
she's
not
as confused as I am.
In the 8 years I've had this particular job, I don't remember boredom cropping up very often anyway.
Nope, I don't get bored very often either. So,
we have a question here from Mr. We're fighting over what's coming up there. Yes, keep that one up a long time so that you can email Bill.
Yes, don't try calling me at the office. Because the phone is usually turned down. It's turned down. Should be turned down. Yeah, it's turned down right now, so it doesn't bother me when I'm doing this kind of stuff. Catch me on the phone is really, really difficult. Just shoot me an email, and as soon as I get a chance to figure out the answer to your question, I'll get back to you as soon as I can.
If you want to call him on the phone and leave a voice message, take note of his voice message to show how... that Dr. Lester is not able to operate an office phone and needs somebody else to leave voice messages, the voice message greeting for him.
No, that's true. I couldn't figure out the phone, so Lily had to do my message for me. I got no problems with that. And the message suggests that you send me an email. If you really want to get a hold of me, if you don't mind waiting potentially a long time, go ahead and leave a voicemail.
Emails are best for me too. I'm at my desk somewhat, but the email follows me around. So, you know, we're more likely to see that.
Yeah, unfortunately, all of us have that issue.
Mm-hmm. Will the poinsettia roots survive one of the Hernando County 25 degree days, then they changed it to nights? I haven't experienced a 25 degree day here. That depends on many factors. That's why we say not to, you know, if you just bought it this year for your Christmas decorations, don't plant it in the landscape until April. Those poinsettias in the A months are when you do things. But the older ones that have been there from the year before, it depends on how long it's going to stay 25 degrees. If it stayed that way for 4 hours or more, it's likely you could lose them. And also it depends on where they are. If they're in a microclimate up near your house or under a tree, they're going to be more protected. It also could be that, you know, they will die to the ground but come back the next year. We haven't had very many root killing freezes in, 10 years?
Yeah, it has to get seriously cold for it to kill things to the roots. Yes. Because the ground always stays a bit warmer, and it has to be really cold for a really long time and not really warm up for that to start happening.
Now, your potted plants are more susceptible with their roots, so you would want to bring those in. Mm-hmm. If you can't, you know, try and bunch them all together and drape a cloth over them, but the cloth has to be reaching the ground, you know. So.
Yeah, and potted poinsettias can freeze and die. So if they're still in the pot, if you leave them sitting outside overnight and it gets really, really cold, the roots and all the soil, because the cold air is right on the other side of the pot, will get the roots cold enough where it will kill them. So poinsettias are native to Mexico. They like it. My guess is they probably do fantastic in South Florida. Here in Central Florida, they do well. Mm-hmm. I can't guarantee it. Depends on where it's planted, how cold it gets in this coming February or whatever. But
again, it's an experiment, because you're probably going to buy it anyway. If you have it, you know, for your home decoration, or you got it as a memorial for church and then you brought that one home. So, you know, keep it in the pot till April and plant it in your yard and see what happens. I think, I'm not sure if you can go somewhere and find one that is actually made for the landscape instead of just your, you know, forest grown holiday ones. That would be something worth looking up, because that would be a stronger type plant then.
There is a native plant that's a type of poinsettia.
Oh yeah, I have those growing naturally. Yeah. They pop up like weeds, yeah.
Because it gets the colorful bracts also, but it's only like half red and half green.
Kind of even on the tip is just pink. I saw them coming up in my flower bed a year ago, maybe two. And so I kept looking at it for a while and mentally asking it if it was a good witch or a bad witch. Then I finally looked it up and saw it's actually a native, our native little poinsettia. They're kind of cute, but they're coming up in the cracks of my sidewalks. And they're, you know, a lovely native weed. So, but they are real narrow leaves. They're not your fancy, you know, Christmas leaves.
And Lee just emailed me a picture of her poinsettia from last year. And it looks like either it's in a container or it's right behind the container that has other plants in it. Either way, looks great. And I'm sure she doesn't have to worry too much about hers freezing and dying. So, because when we start getting freezes down that far south, that...
It can happen. Frostproof is not. I've seen freezes happen.
It's not yet. Absolute. It's generally frostproof.
That's a marketing name.
Yeah. Hers is still in the container, so you can keep it in the container. You can plant it in the ground. You can put it in a container in the ground. You can put it in a container on top of a tree stump. If you had to have a tree removed, just cut it real low and use this container plant stand. That can look very attractive.
And if you forget about your poinsettia, like if you go on vacation over Christmas, or you just happen to have put it outside meaning to do something to it and you didn't, and then there's this dead poinsettia, that's okay too. We still love you, and it will provide nice things to your compost pile. So.
There you go. And going back a few comments, Lee asked about, when are you doing the recipe series? And I wrote that one down here also.
Yeah.
Need to start planning for the coming new year. Mm-hmm. So I'll drag somebody on here with some recipes. I know people. And
Bibi had planted her or his poinsettia in March. It's probably all right.
Sure, that's fine. Because rule of thumb with poinsettias is you do want to work on them in the months that begin with A. Mm-hmm. So in April, they're bloomed out from the holidays at that point. So you can trim them up, clean them up, get rid of the dead flowers, dead bracts, stuff like that. Get them all set for spring growth. They're going to grow during the spring. Poinsettias, especially if you put them outside, tend to get kind of leggy.
They do.
So that's why in August you want to go back and trim them back a little bit to make them a little bit more compact and bushy and not real leggy. You want to prune off any, they'll get spider mites. They'll get a few other pests. Not really bad normally, but they can. So you can prune off any damaged stuff. So in August, it's all cleaned up and compact. After that, leave it alone. And it will grow back out and start to develop the flowers and the colorful leaves and bracts on the tips. And hopefully around Christmas, and we can't guarantee it will happen Christmas Day, but sometime during the winter is when they're going to flower and color up and get that holiday look to them.
And if you want to, if you're in Hernando County and happen to have to go to the courthouse, I guess it is the courthouse again. It's not so much the government center anymore.
Yeah, I still call it that. I need to figure out what to call it.
Your master gardeners have created a wonderful, they maintain a wonderful interior scape in the atrium there. And it's all done for Christmas. So worth taking a look if you happen to be going in there. And there are pictures of it on both of our Facebook pages.
Yes, yes, there is. And I have another picture coming up in a moment here. Lee also asked if I planted my weary, weary pepper. And no, I haven't yet. But here, I'll be starting my seeds for tomatoes and peppers in just a few weeks. I do it between Christmas and New Year's. And I'm going to try growing them. Weary. Lily, you try saying that.
Well, I can't see the word. Where?
Oh, W-I-R-I, W-I-R-I. And that is the common
weary
name.
I would say no, because it's a W. Weary.
Okay. Weary, weary peppers are native to, I guess, Central America, Guyana, and areas around there. And it's a very, very widely used hot pepper down there. They use it fresh. They dry it. They use the powder. They throw it in scrambled eggs. They throw it in, like, everything down there because they like the hot peppers down there.
Yeah.
And it's Lee was kind enough to send me some last year, and I dried them, and it is very good. I'm gonna try growing some this year.
Lee says it is pronounced weary, weary, like you're saying it.
Yeah, weary, weary.
Are they tired? Perhaps they
need,
so. Or if they're so weary, they need to participate in your gardening meditation series. You actually, I mean, with your voice and that music, that would go. I'll write it for you, and you can read it to that music, and we'll relax people.
Now, we're going to get some help with that one. And we are going to do garden meditation on here one Thursday. I'll let everybody know in advance so that you can be prepared and dressed in a quiet room. And we will do garden meditation.
All the classes that we did when we were both working from home during COVID, and even some of the YouTube things we've done since then, because of the year that I worked from home at COVID, and I would talk to you, do classes with you, talk to you all the time on Zoom or the StreamYard. Now, when I need my dogs to relax, if I'm going away or something, they lay in their kennels, and I sometimes turn on Dr. Bill so they can listen to one of the classes because they're so used to hearing your voice. So, see, you're the dog whisperer as well. You put everyone right to sleep.
Great, thanks. We play music. Our dogs love classical music, and now you can put on Christmas music and Christmas kind of calm, yeah, instrumental. We really like to keep the house calm and stress-free and not all the lights on, every TV turned up full blast, Facebook videos playing full blast. Don't like that.
Oh, Cindy is suggesting a nighttime garden. You can have a special episode in the evening. Lots of plants that bloom at night, there are.
There are. Where could we find a garden with plants that are blooming at night, though?
I don't know.
Nothing blooming in my yard at night.
I don't know if it's on YouTube, but I know I've done a class on it might be in some of the spooky gardens where it's mentioned some of the night bloomers that are like ghostly apparitions. Oh, see, you're writing all these ideas down.
I'm writing this down.
Okay. That's another thing you'll want to bring in if we're going to have a freeze, are your night blooming serious and those type of things as well. Okay,
looks like it's about that time. I'll keep squeezing in the final comments here. If you guys have anything else you want to share it quickly.
Okay, Cindy, I'll see if I have that class somewhere, or else I might put it on my list of things to do. Night gardens.
we need to do a class and intersperse a lot of shot video on how to build a nightmare invasive garden. Because I know people, there are yards I drive past, and I know of one yard, and it's going to be kind of tough to go and shoot a video of it and have the guy come out and say, why are you taking a video? Because you're growing nothing but invasive plants, and it looks like, you know what? And people might not take that the right way. And like,
I don't know. I don't think there's a good way to take that.
But no, it's funny how some people have literally nothing but invasive plants in your yard.
Yeah.
Because they grow really well.
Mm-hmm. Yep. Okay, well, I think it's almost time.
Yes, I think so. So, hey, everybody, thank you so much for joining us. I'll be back here next Thursday. I've got pretty much nothing on my calendar for next week. A couple little odds and ends.
What is today? The 8th? So, yeah, I'll be, as far as I know, I'll be here. I'm not going, believe it or not, I'm not... As far as I know, I'm not leaving the state in December. they're always that caveat, as far as I know.
So. Yeah. I'm not going anywhere. We're not planning on traveling or anything. Yeah. So rest up a little bit, try to get some time in my garden and get things planted and started and moving in the right direction for spring. Because before you know it, spring is going to be here. So.
It comes very quickly in Florida. So.
Yes, it does. Before you even really realize this winter, it's spring.
That's right.
Okay. Well, hey, everybody, thank you so much for joining us. And we will see you again next Thursday morning at 10 a.m. I'll be here. Lily will be here. Maybe I can find somebody else who's free to be on here, too. Sure. Why not?
Yep.
Okay. Thanks again. Bye, everybody.
Thank you, everybody. Have a great week.